can speak about the clinics and the clinical things. And we have two renominated speakers from Oncore and Hazelier Dresden. This is a huge laser institution and a huge research institution on radiation, dedicated to radiation oncology. And we have, fortunately, a close cooperation with these two institutions and two renominated members came here to speak about the biological, radiation biological aspects of the ionizing radiation and the medical physics aspects of the ionizing radiation. So let's start immediately. We will speak about ionizing radiation the whole day. This, as I told, ion radiation oncologist, is very important how the cancers can be treated. And the only modality prior to 1895 was the surgery, which is a very failing method, and especially prior to this time, without proper anesthesia. But some of the tumors has been treated already in the old ancient Egypt. So the surgery is an effective method to remove the tumor. But fortunately, at that time, for a point, Wilhelm Conrad Röntgen has discovered the X-rays, and this is the X-ray image of her wife's hand. And this opened the potential of development of two huge disciplines. The first X-ray tube was built with a heated anode, which is emitting electrons, the permanent emissions. It is accelerated here and hitting a target. This is a cathode, and this is an anode covered with metal, and X-ray produced that these are hitting the target. The other huge discovery occurred 1 year later. It is the radioactivity of the spontaneous decay of the different nucleus, which result in alpha particles, gamma rays, and beta particles, which are the electrons, the charged particles. And this two large discovery led to the development of two huge disciplines, the radiation diagnostics and radiotherapy. Both of them are used in cancer treatment because the advanced imaging is highly important for planning the cancer treatment and for discovering the tumors in early stage and to describe the location, the extent of the tumors, so the stage, defining the stage of the disease. And the advanced diagnostic includes as well as the pathological, histopathological, and molecular diagnostics too. And recently, the more and more knowledge is accumulating, we need interdisciplinary discussions because none of the persons are able to collect all of the knowledge of each disciplines. So everybody should add the highest updated version of the possibilities. And of course, due to the advanced diagnostic, an earlier detection is possible, more probability to cure a patient. And with complex treatment modalities, including chemotherapy, surgery, radiotherapy, and the recently emerging systemic therapeutical approaches of molecularly targeted therapies and immunotherapies, are led to much more function preservation, prolongation of the survival, and especially, it is very important, qualitative survival. So the complexity and addition of these modalities to each others result in a much better function preservation and a much better quality of life. And in this all this complexity, the radiotherapy is one of the leading roles. And around 15 million patients, unfortunately,
radiation therapy. It is very important. It is comparable to surgery.
We would like to remove the tumor. So it is a local regional treatment method. It is important. And it is the directed energy deposition to the human body directly to a certain target, which includes the tumor. And the unit of it is joule per kilogram, energy per mass. This is the gray. What is happening during this radiation? What do you think? How many percent, I ask you, how many percent of the energy which is absorbed by a material is used for ionization? How many percent, what kind of other reactions may occur due to the energy deposition? If a material gets energy, what can happen? What may happen with the energy? You can guess, you should not know. What kind of reactions may occur?
Ionization.
Sorry?
No, sorry, what is the question?
Yes, if a material absorbs, gets energy, what may occur with this energy?
Energy level goes higher.
Yes.
And release some energy.
Release some particles or something like this. Release some.
The energy can be transformed in other forms.
Yes. Heating, for example. But and there is a small, very small portion of temperature increase, which can be used for calorimetric dosimetry, but more than 99% of the energy which is absorbed will be for ionization. Electrons are moving, and negative and positive ions occurring. This is used in the form, this radiation, ionizing radiation, in a form in the clinic as radioactive isotopes, as fluids given in an infusion and exposed to the total body. Can be used in a form of brachytherapy. We will see it's solid, needles or seeds deposited in the tumor or in the tumor-bearing cavity, and in the form of teletherapy, which is particle beam directed toward the patient from a certain distance. After this very quick procedure of ionization, the next procedure is the chemical process. Free oxygen radicals released, mainly from water radiolysis, hydroxy radicals, but lipid peroxidation and other peroxides are occurring, and there are a portion of direct effects which changes directly the macromolecules. The more densely ionizing is a radiation, more direct effect is occurring. And after the first free oxygen radical production, a chain reaction may be released, as well as particularly in lipids, and it aggravate or accelerate the whole biological process, and it can cause damages in different subcellular organelles. What do you think? Which are the most sensitive parts of a cell? Which will be damaged? Which molecules, large molecules, will be damaged? DNA, yes. Proteins itself, so what are the proteins doing in a cell? Like catalyzing procedures, enzymes, and there are signaling pathways with different proteins taking part in them, and so on. And membranes, and all of these damages may lead to serious changes, which can be either repaired or which cause major procedures later on. So you can see, for example, this is a simplified image, how many procedures are taking place in order to regulate a
cell. A cell is a very complex, a highly complex system with strict regulation of genomic regulation, regulation of the proliferation of the cell-induced death, the apoptosis, and so on. And each changes in this macromolecules may cause a change in this signaling pathways, and as a result of it, in the proliferation procedure or in the life of the cells. And it can cause an early senescence, and the cell will die. Mitotic catastrophe, it can induce apoptosis or necrosis. The DNA damage itself can be either repaired or can stay longer or can cause after a while the death of the cell. So if I summarize all of that, what I have told, the first procedure is the energy absorption at atomic level, then in molecular, at molecular level, ionization and free radical production start. At macromolecular level, large molecules, DNA, proteins, lipids is very important as well as, are damaged. And it causes metabolical, regulational, and structural changes at the membrane level or at the organelle, subcellular organs, organelle levels. And finally, at the tissue level, it releases cytokines and vessel changes, functional changes, mainly locally. It is very important that the energy deposition can be directed. So everything which we cause, the major damages, is caused in the volume which is irradiated. But sometimes, due to the cytokine release in the neighboring tissues, changes which can be not seen directly as a cause of ionizing radiation, but indirectly due to the neighboring effect, and even far from the localized tumor, sometimes some reaction may occur. Not very frequently, only 5-10% of the cases, it happens that locally a tumor is irradiated effectively, a huge tumor necrosis, tumor shrinkage is caused, and some of the metastases in the lung or far from that place what was irradiated has a response as well as. It is the abscopal effect, which is highly studied recently because it is highly important in the association with the immunotherapy and with the enhancement of the effect of the lately emerging immunotherapy. So finally, we go back to the local effects. In the tissues, inflammatory and pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory procedures are released. And due to that fact, inflammatory reactions can be seen, swelling and redness in the irradiated area, and hopefully damages in the tumor cells during the radiation and in the early time, some weeks and months after. And later on, it causes radiation, these damages due to the early senescence or necrosis or mitotic catastrophe. It finally led to radiation necrosis, which caused thereafter organ function impairment in the healthy tissue, or hopefully, while we are using this method, the damage of the and the disappearance of the tumor. This whole procedure is taking place in time, and it is very important that the time scale starts with pico and microseconds from the excitation of the atoms and radical formation and the repair mechanism and all of the inflammatory, pro-inflammatory activation signaling pathway activation occurring during hours. Usually, a repair can be finished important later on if we think about how to fraction the radiation. And thereafter, after hours or days, we can see the functional changes, the inflammatory reactions, and even some years later, we can see the late effects, or hopefully the tumor disappearance. And we should not forget about that we are causing damages in cells which just survive. And these surviving cells with the DNA damages may develop later what? What can we do? A cancer, yes. Because they are such like damages which caused a malignant transformation of may cause malignant transformation. So this is a danger in the cancer, in the ionizing, use of ionizing radiation, that after 10 years or after decades, it can cause cancer induction. What is characterizing radiation? It is very important which particle we use for radiation. Actually, today, if incidentally we don't use neutrons, which is always contaminated with photons, we use always one particle for irradiation, which can be photon and electron in the majority of the cases, but sometimes hadrons can be used as well as, which means the nuclear particles, protons, neutrons, or heavy ions. The quality of the particle means that a the type of the particle defines the density of the ionization, the deposition in dose deposition, energy deposition in space, and it is defining the biological effectivity of a certain particle. And we will see later on that the charged particle have additionally a special feature, a special characteristic in the dose deposition. So the quality of the particle is defining the dose deposition in space. The other thing which is defining as well as the dose deposition in depth is the energy. The intensity means the number of particles, and the dose rate is the dose per time unit. The linear energy transfer is as well as an important definition. This is keV per micrometer, which means that the energy is deposited in a certain way. And this is again defining the ionization density. The higher the LET, the higher the density of the ionization, and higher is the biological effectivity. More effectively, damaging, we can damage the large molecules, the proteins, and the DNA. And this RBE means that relative biological effectivity, which means that we compare for a certain biological endpoint the dose which is needed to release this endpoint by reference radiation, by photons, for example, and by, let's say, heavy ion radiation. So it is demonstrated here that the low LET, low linear energy transfer irradiation, isolated lesions occurs, and more easy to, easier to repair them. Meanwhile, with dense ionization, energy deposition is happening in a small space, and it grows faster lesions with higher relative biological effectivity. How can you imagine this biological effectivity? What does it mean really? For example, if I need to destroy half of the tumor, let's say half of the tumor, with 20 gray, and with another particle, I need only 5 gray, what is the relative biological effectivity? 20 gray for the same endpoint with photons, and 5 gray with this other radiation. What is the biological effectivity? for every kind of such like reactions, the best would be if we could get the radiation which is so effective against cancer and does not touch at all the healthy tissues. The cell cycle effect is as well as important because the cancer cells, and unfortunately there are healthy cells as normal cells in the body which are multiplying themselves, but the cancer cells are quite quickly proliferating, and the S phase is the most radio resistant, and the G1 phase has an intermediate position. The mitotic phase and the phase prior to it, the G2, is the most radio sensitive. And this is very important because we have sometimes combined methods when we synchronizing this multiplication process, and we can achieve that the majority of the tumor cells will stay longer in G2 and mitotic phase, and it means that we can hit more effectively the cells. So, summarizing all of this, what I have told, what are the most important factors influencing the biological effects? At microscopic level, the cell cycle, which I have shown previously, because free oxygen radicals are occurring. Therefore, the oxygenization of the cells are very important. Why? If a patient himself, herself, has anemia and a low amount of oxygen, what is the problem with that? There could be not so effectively free oxygen. For oxygen radicals, what is needed? Oxygen. So these are oxygen radicals. So if there are not enough oxygen, and in a large tumor, have anybody seen ever a large tumor? A large tumor can be even 1 kilogram. Yesterday I have seen 2.5 kilogram tumor. It was awful. Okay, so there are frequently quite, I tell it kilogram, of course, we are not measuring all the kilogram in the tumor only to have a vision on it. So if there is a large tumor, what do you think? How the blood supply can care of this tumor? The outer part of the tumor is well supported because there are blood vessels, but the central part of the tumor has very few oxygen, very few blood supply. There are, of course, mechanisms which build a little bit pathologic vessels which supply better the internal part as the head, but the tumor growth is so quick that it is in the majority of the cases when the tumor grows quite large, it is impossible. So in the middle of the cell, there are very few oxygen. And therefore, there could be cells which are surviving a very effective radiation because there is no oxygen which can provide, which is necessary for free radical production. Then, what is as well as important, the type of the cell which is hit by the radiation, even if it is normal or cancer cell, the regeneration capacity and a lot of other intrinsic factors are defining the radiosensitivity of this cell type. Nowadays, we know more and more about the molecular background of the radiosensitivity. And at macroscopic level, at a complete organism level, it is very important how old is this patient, what is his her nutritional status, whether he or she has diabetes, other comorbidity, anemia. Why is anemia is so important? The anemia means that the oxygen level is lower in the whole body. It is, we have spoken about, because of free oxygen radicals. It is very important what kind of medication this patient has, and of course, depending which healthy tissue is surrounding the tumor, what is the tumor size, what is the tumor type, the spread of the tumor, the vascular invasion and the vascularization of the tumor. And of course, so there are microscopic factors which are influencing the effect of the ionizing radiation. There are complex factors due to the tumor and due to the patient itself. And what is very important and what we can influence and what we will speak about the whole day is the radiation quality, doses, fractionation, and combinations. In order to get as much tumor shrinkage, as much tumor cell death as possible in order to cure the patient, in order to achieve organ and function preservation, or at least to release the symptoms of the patient by achieving a certain amount of tumor shrinkage. But of course, we have to decrease as much as possible the normal tissue effects, which can be acute reactions due to the inflammatory reactions and late reactions due to the irreversible death of the normal cells. This is the scar tissue building which can cause ulceration or organ function deterioration. And we should not forget about the tumor induction, which may occur after decays sometimes. But recently, we have seen two procedures. The growth of the cancer incidence, more and more patients are diagnosed, let's say, because a part of this cancer incidence increase is not a real increase, but due to the better diagnostic, we can see much more cancer patients. But unfortunately, the real incidence is as well as increasing. And the other tendency is that we can see cancers in earlier ages. The childhood cancers are fortunately not very frequent, but occurs. And if a child should be treated with ionizing radiation, we have to really consider the tumor induction of the ionizing radiation. And finally, all of this balance, which we are have to decide for each patient and globally for working out protocols for a certain tumor type, we have to achieve the best therapeutic index, which means the best tumor response with the less side effects. And in the oncology, what is very good, that everything is well categorized. We can always work statistically because both the such like thing that tumor response, it is very well categorized. There is a very strict definition of complete remission, partial remission, minimal change, stable disease, progressive disease, local control, overall survival, time to progression, progression-free survival, and so on. And the side effects, the toxicity is as well as we have a booklet, and we can see that a certain change is a grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4 side effects. So everything can be translated to a number, and we can calculate the therapeutic effect, which has a lot of efforts to increase, to improve the therapeutic effect. Because if we have a certain radiation modality applying a certain dose to the patient, achieving tumor control, which we would like, of course, 100%, but it is never possible. Let's say 90% of the local tumor control could be achieved for the price of a certain amount of side effects, the complication probability. And if we use, for example, radiation modifiers, which are sensitizing selectively only the cancer cells and not the normal cells, or we are using radiation protector agents, which are only protecting the normal cells. Yes, thank you. attention to the other modalities, we can irradiate the patient pre-operatively, post-operatively, intra-operatively. We can add chemotherapy sequentially or concomitantly in the same time. And we can refine the delivery of the radiation as each day once, each day two times, at least 8 hours in between the two fractions. What do you think? I mentioned something at the very beginning. Why 8 hours difference in between the two fractions are enough? That is enough.
It's a cycle.
Yes. One opinion was cell cycle. Other approach. There were a time scale. Yes. On the different procedures. What is the first stage, which is occurring? Ionization. Thereafter?
Free radical
production. What is the time scale of occurring the free radicals?
Milliseconds.
Very good. And don't forget about it, because the laser-induced radiation has special features, you will see, and it is important to remember that. And what happens thereafter? Free radicals are there. What the free radicals are doing? Yes, they have reactions with the large molecules, the proteins, DNA and membrane, proteins, membrane, lipids, yes. And what is happening with the DNA damage? The cell makes a lot of effort, each cell makes a lot of efforts indicating different or activating different signaling pathways, inflammatory, pro-inflammatory procedures to repair it. And this reparation time is around 6-8 hours. So if the cell is normal and has a normal capacity, normal repair capacity, then we can expect that after 8 hours we can give the next fraction. And if you remember very well that the Syed cycle is very important for example, for synchronization. But in that case, because of the repair procedures, this hyperfractionated schedules can be used, which means two times or three times per day a patient can be irradiated. And this was really shown in the clinic that the hyperfractionated radiation was more effective from the point of view of cancer damage, and there were not increased late reactions, but the acute reactions increased, but they are cured from themselves. But unfortunately, in the practice, in the normal daily routine, it is very difficult to achieve. Can you imagine that there is a radiotherapy department where each patient is coming three times per day, at 8 o'clock in the morning, at, and in the middle of the night? It is quite difficult to organize such like things, so it was organized only in the frame of clinical studies, and there came other protocols, Chartwell and Sechrek, without weekend or only two times per day, these hyperfractionated regimes were used. And recently, due to the increase, due to the technical development, there is a huge increase in spatial selectivity, that dose deposition could be applied much more selectively than previously. Only the tumors are beaten and the neighboring organs are very well protected. So in that case, with the advent of the absolute new technology, new generation linear accelerators, nowadays new regimes are coming into the clinic, which is the opposite of the hyperfractionation. It is the hyperfractionation. It is the hypofractionation, which means that the doses up to 6-10 rays applied in a single fraction, and the whole radiation is lasting only 5-10 days at maximum, because in that case the physical selectivity allow a very effective protection, and in that case the vascular damage is higher and the biological effect summary, the fractionation, which means the timing of the radiation, played a very important role both for the protection of the normal cells and in the enhancement of the cancer killing, and in both directions, to accelerate the fractionation or to deaccelerate, to use higher fractions, is actually used and in the clinic daily. This is how the different combined modalities are working. So if chemotherapy, targeted therapies, radiosensitizing chemotherapy is applied, then all of the procedures which is released by the ionizing radiation. Do you remember which kind of cell regulation, the damages, and the apoptosis induction, and so on, will be enhanced in a manner that it has not only an additional effect, but a super additive effect due to the combination of the damages and increase of the repair and synchronization of the cells. And I would like to show some examples from the clinic. For example, the non-small cell cancer are treated with daily, with weekly, or with each 4 weeks paclitaxel and carboplatin chemotherapy. The standard for glioblastoma multiforme, which is one of the most awful brain tumors, temozolomide, which is as well as an alkylating agent, is applied daily in addition to the radiation. Even it is important when the patient gets the chemotherapy, in which time point and when the radiation is delivered. The concomitant chemoradiotherapy for head and neck cancer can be done with cisplatinum or with molecular agent, which is targeting the epidermal growth factor receptor at the cell surface. And there are huge development of different agents which can be combined at a certain level of the signaling pathways or membrane receptors, which has an effect on the radiation itself, enhancing, achieving a supra-additive effect. I have not mentioned conventional fractionation. I was speaking about hyperfractionation and hypofractionation, but what was used in empirically introduced in the clinic in the 1920s, but it turned out that a single fraction of radiation caused a lot of head tissue damage, then a huge radiobiological work was done, and it turned out that the fractionation prevent this effect, and the normal daily fractionation, the convention, is 2 gray or 1.8 gray. For damaging, for destroying a complete tumor, an average size head and neck tumor, we need 70 gray. How many times will the patient come if we apply conventional fractionation? It is only to awake you.
33 days.
Exactly, 33 days. 35 days, yes. If 7. It's possible to give 66 gray if we apply radiosensitizer. So maybe we are thinking about that. That the fractionation, as I said, is important, and the overall treatment time, which can be accelerated as well as, yeah. So what is the technical development which led to increased selectivity and better dose deposition to the well-defined target, which is as well as important? Nowadays we can achieve millimeter accuracy for dose delivery, and what is very important and what is very difficult to achieve this millimeter accuracy to define the target. I don't know which is your background, but if someone has ever sat in front of CT or MRI images and tried to draw the borders of the tumor knows exactly that there are a lot of uncertainty. Is it belonging to the tumor, or it is already the health tissue, and this 1 millimeter or some millimeter certainty to achieve that it is very, very difficult. So the selective homogeneous irradiation of the target became possible, and recently, not the homogeneous, but there are possibilities to define sub-values within the target volume, which may be less sensitive to the radiation. Why? What can be the cause of such like sub-volume, which is less sensitive to the radiation? Yes, yes, it is very, 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 very good answer. It is possible that these are cells which are intrinsically less sensitive to radiation. And what other? In the center of the tumor?
No,
center part. Yes, the hypoxia may occur due to the less blood vessel. So it is important that recently we are able to define small volumes which can be in the same time inhomogeneously irradiated in a well-defined manner. And of course we try to decrease the normal tissue complication probability in order to increase the preparation.